thank you very much for the introduction. Sorry for the delay. We had some trouble setting up the audio. It's hopefully somewhat working now. So this talk is about the FCC regulations. It's actually a follow-up talk from the talk which we had last year at the previous Battle Mesh. And this is basically a status update and a panel discussion. So the structure here is I will give an introduction about the FCC regulations. Some of who you who have been here last year, you will know about that, but there are also some updates what happened. We will have an update on the EU situation by Max, who's with us through the conference. I hope he can stay. And then we will have an open discussion for we can sell it. And one of the new rules which was introduced is that if you are using radio on 5 GHz, then you must implement some kind of device security to prevent use of illegal radio parameters. And by now there's also similar rulings in the EU. That's that one directive, 2014/53/EU, and also in Canada. So some other countries adopted the ideas. So what is the rulings about? I mean, we had these rulings before. What is illegal? So for example, in 2.4 gigahertz, you can't use illegal channels, illegal frequencies. In the US, that would be, for example, on 2.4 gigahertz, channel 12, 13, 14. You're not allowed to use too high transmission power. If you want to use the channels between 5.3 and 5.7 gigahertz, then you must implement DFS functionality. DFS is dynamic frequency selection. And what happens is in that radio range, there are primary users. These are radars, and a Wi-Fi card must be able to detect a radar. And if it detects a radar, it must move to another channel and not use that channel anymore, which is used by the radar. And that's especially interesting also for Doppler weather radars, which are used near airports. That's especially relevant for about 45 airports in the US. And these radars operate on only a small band, only on 5.6 to 5.65 gigahertz. And there are also even more strict rules for them. This is picture what happens if you don't implement DFS. So most hardware is just able to tune on that channel, and if you don't implement DFS, then you don't recognize the radar and just stay on the frequency, and the radar will have disturbances. So if you see, that's a map of Germany. Here's Berlin, and you see these interesting clouds around Berlin. Nah, that's not chemtrails. Nope, that's coming from radars. So basically, most probably Wi-Fi access points, or maybe other devices which are not implementing DFS. Okay, FCC rules. That's copied from the rules, and it basically says that manufacturers must implement security features so that third parties are not able to reprogram the device to operate outside the parameters for which the device was certified, and that's especially for the radio part. It doesn't say lock down all the firmware or something. It says don't. You must ensure that the device is not used in frequencies, for example, which are not allowed or without DFS. They don't say how you do it. They just say you must make sure, and they give a couple of ideas how to implement that. Like they say private networks, electronic signatures, and other means. Okay. And since this is a DFS, sorry, it's a FCC rule, the manufacturers must make sure that this is not possible. So they basically shift the responsibilities from the users to the manufacturers. So if I want to release a new device, then I before I can sell it in the US, I must show that that it's conforming to these rules. And this is how we learned about it first, because we wanted to sell a new device in the US, and then we gave a new questionnaire from the FCC. That's not the rules, but something more simple, so manufacturers can just answer to these questions, right? And one of the interesting parts, this is actually updated, and the DDWRT part is removed by now. The rest is as it is. It says, what prevents third parties from loading non-US versions of software firmware on the device? Describe in detail how the device is protected from flashing and the installation of third-party firmware such as DDWRT. That was really specific. As I said, the DDWRT part is removed by now. There was a press release from the FCC which says, oh, we don't want to forbid that, and we changed these questions, so everything is fine now, right? I don't think it is. So what is the problem? Highly integrated SoC designs make it difficult to lock only the radio parameters. And if there's no possibility to lock the hardware by a prime radio, firmware, etc., then the manufacturers have to lock the next more big thing, and that's the firmware, right? If it's not possible to make that separation. And as you can imagine, locking firmware is not desirable for us. We can't load OpenWRT on these devices anymore. And we have all these old problems which are usually solved by installing alternative firmwares, like security problems, having new features, performance enhancements, and all the wireless communities are stuck with hardware which they can't reprogram, and this is what we want. So, but we could say, why do we care in the EU? Well, the US market for electronics is one of the biggest markets in the world, and FCC regulations are adopted by other countries, not necessarily EU, but also other countries which don't bother to make their own rulings, which probably is a good thing. And there are trade agreements, like if a device is FCC approved, then you can use it in that country too. That's, for example, in Mexico or Canada, there are trade agreements, and also many other countries. And yeah, if vendors start to lock down their hardware, sometimes they don't just limit that only for US and keep it open for Mexico. They just limit all of it. And that actually happened. We were warning about that last year, and now we see it happened. For example, TP-Link locked down their firmware. And the devices you buy now in the EU are locked too. And they didn't even only lock it for 5 gigahertz only. Even 2.4 gigahertz only routers have that lock. There's also, I heard rumors, I didn't confirm them myself, for ubiquity access points, and maybe there are some more vendors. I would expect that more vendors do the same thing. Right, so this is the timeline, what happened. In 2014, the FCC started to accept test reports according to the updated rules. Then in May 2015, also Canada adopted these rulings for their own regulations in a similar way. In 2015, June, they stopped approving test reports according to the old rules. I think that was postponed to later, maybe December, I'm not sure about that. So from that point on, if you want to approve a new device, then you first have to use the new rules, and only the new rules, right? in sometime February, the TP-Link lockdown was confirmed. That was also on the Battle Mesh mailing list, and lots of news sites reported on that. And the guy asked TP-Link, why do you do that? And the answer was, because of the new FCC rules. From June 1st, 2016 in the US, it's not allowed to market devices which are certified under the old rules anymore. If you recertified for the new rules, it's fine, but any old devices is not allowed to be marketed anymore. That basically means you can't show it on your web shop, you can't put it in the store, so it's probably the old devices might still be available upon request, but they will be pretty much gone from the shelves. And also in June 13, the European countries need to implement a directive, all the member states have to implement that directive. I think Max will give us an update on that specifically. And by next year, 1 year after, all of the new devices must be certified. So there's also a transition time. I don't think that in the EU they have that hard sales stop, but yeah, we get more or less similar rules. So one interesting point is not only Wi-Fi access points are affected, but basically also smartphones, tablets, laptops, who have some Wi-Fi chip which supports 5 gigahertz and can tune to these frequencies and can tune can be configured as access point are affected as well. Where's the microphone? Can you please give the microphone to Henning?
How do you lock down a laptop? Because this would allow users not to use any kind of device driver anymore.
I don't know, but there's someone else, maybe.
They are already locked down since a long time because of the FCC rules, at least that's says the vendors. So every
they're not locking down the laptop.
We have a 10-second delay in the stream, so please continue.
This is Will Lumpkins. I happen to work for the IEEE Consumer Electronics Magazine as a volunteer. But in my night job, not my day job, I do FCC and CE compliance. I guess the funny thing here is the FCC implemented this only because of the ETC-EN 301-893, because the European Union notified the FCC they were going to do it. So the FCC went to implement it themselves. And they were a little bit faster to get it done than the European Union. That was the big scramble. I know Marvell, Intel, everyone was scrambling to try to make sure they were in compliance of the European Union regulation, because most US companies are worried about not being able to sell into the European Union. It really didn't come from the US. The US never cared. Now they may not have written, the FCC may not have written their document very well, because the FCC aren't technical. They're a bunch of administrative guys in the government who open up for draft and RFCs asking for input. So I think it's kind of funny. And you can absolutely lock down the radio. It's not that hard. What generally happens is chip vendors produce an API because they're afraid of people knowing the register settings of the part of the Mac and the radio layer. So they make an API so you can make API calls, because everyone's freaked out that TI is going to know about the Broadcom version, or it's going to know about the Intel version. And so because of that, they put an API in. But you can absolutely lock the radio portion. Actually, even to do the ETC test and the FCC test, you have to load a special firmware to put it into prohibitive modes so you can do an EVM mask test to be able to make sure you don't violate the EVM mask requirements on the ETS EN 301-893, as well as the mass tests for the FCC. So that is allowed. And what happens with that special firmware, you get that special firmware from the chip vendor like Marvell or Intel. The real issue here is not to make sure that someone does something wrong, which your community wouldn't be doing that. And I think everyone agrees, and I think Simon has established this quite correctly, your community just wants to have free flow of information. What we need to do is we need to educate the FCC and make sure the documentation is clear and understandable so that when people go in, to bring forth a new requirement, they're not flipped out. So, for example, when my customers go to submit that and they ask that question, how is it locked down? We just answer a simple one-liner. Oh, it's locked down through the firmware. And the FCC doesn't care. And it moves forward.
Okay. I didn't properly understand all of that. But to summarize, it was that the EU actually started that whole thing. This is what I heard. Do you agree to that? And the other thing was about the API or that can be locked down. There's another comment over here.
Yes, the EU is the one that started it. The FCC decided that they wanted to follow in line with it.
Okay. We have another comment here.
So my comment or question here is, and I've been trying to track this issue since it's been known, but it's still
also
not
clear. Remember, if you test something in the FCC, you automatically do not work in Mexico, you automatically do not work in Canada. What happens is, if you pass that test, very likely you could pass in Canada, but you have to pay the fee, right? I mean, this whole FCC thing is about money, right? I mean, there's part, not just FCC, but every country, right? For Canada, you have to get the IC test done. It's called the IC Canada test. Now, if you pass the FCC part, chapter 15, part B, you will most likely pass. But if you pass the FCC 15, there's a good chance you won't pass the FCEN 301. It's a different mask requirement. So what people always do in the U.S. is we always test for the FCC version, and then you test for the CE mark version. And once you pass both the European and the U.S., generally you'll pass everywhere, though that's not completely true if you test in China, because they have a slightly different mask variant. But all the other countries, they tend to go with whatever the FCC or the CE, so you can submit those test results, and then you pay your fee, and then they most likely will accept it.
Okay. You please go on, and then I will go through the slides, because actually we have all the discussions afterwards. So, yeah, please.
Okay. So my comment or my big doubt here is, where did this come from? Was this just a big mess where the FCC and the EU don't know what they are doing? Or is there a purpose or a push from some lobby or someone who is interested in this happening? Because for me, this is not clear at all. And everything points to something like, this is a big mess and they don't know what they are doing. And this is what this guy seems to be saying.
Yes, so I also don't know where this comes from. I would hold that question for after we finish with the slides and Max's status report. So, okay. So about phones and tablets, I didn't really hear a lot of that, if that's locked down or more or less locked down. I think it's harder to flash them anyways, but yeah, they are also affected. What happened so far is, last year we had a similar workshop which raised a lot of awareness. After the following months, we had about 3,000 comments on the FCC. They had an open comment section where you could file things. There was a safe Wi-Fi initiative. We have the Free Software Foundation Europe joint statement against the radio lockdown. And Max will tell about that in a couple of minutes. We have mailing lists at Purple Foundation mail servers, as well as on BufferPload, where you can discuss, organize, and countermeasures, or just discuss on the status, as we do here. What we have to say is that FCC rules, they are still in place as they have been proposed. So there was no change. I think there was a little delay or postponing of the transition time, but there is no change. Technical workarounds and ideas, if we encounter that. So one of the things also Will mentioned, and also other people, is to split radio and the Linux host system. For example, one way I was thinking of is to having a minimal signed firmware. Right now they are usually not signed, but maybe that's possible. Then we can say, hey, it's signed, we have an electronic signature, that's okay. And convince that it's enough. Maybe someone of you is working with chip vendors. That's another question for later. One point what was raised is to use just general purpose boards and PC Express Wi-Fi cards, because the general purpose boards maybe don't fall under that or are easier to certify, but I think it's just a loophole or something, like a hole in the regulations, which will be fixed eventually. And another one was to localize hardware for not affected markets, like for South America. We have Guido here who can tell us more about that. But this still doesn't solve the problem for US and EU. And one point is, do we really have to work around that? I think it's not the right way to work around these rules, but we should actually change them. So I think solving the radar problem or the weather radar problem, if it's only that, if this regulation seems to be shooting with big cannons on the sparrow, that's a German idiom. So an alternative would be to keep the responsibility to the users and drive around with a radio van as it was done before, right? So, and then you have high fines, like you say, okay, you violate that, then you pay $50,000 or euros or whatever, and then you have a good incentive to not doing that. I think even in Germany we had cases where there were fines and they were also in the range of 20,000 euro. This is what I heard. And it's usually not for all the firmwares, but for many it's pretty hard to break the rules by mistake.
But remember, that only works if you're fixed and you never move. It's really, really hard to track someone. If they're mobile, you'll never find them.
So the comment from Will was that it's hard to track. Two years ago we had a talk from another guy who was showing how to track. We have to say it was a static installation, but he was able to pinpoint that in a range of, I think, 20 square kilometers or so. And he was driving around and measuring signal strengths, and he was able to track the guy who disturbed the network within a couple of hours. So yes, it takes an effort, and I would agree that tracking mobile users is not so easy, but most of these 5 gigahertz installations with high power are static from my personal experience. And these static, I'm pretty sure they can be tracked. How big is the problem? According to Eric Schulz's slides, there were 10 cases in 7 years in the U.S. and all of them.
Again, I disagree, and mostly because the FCC only has a couple vans per state in the U.S. They have to wait for a huge amount of inflow of people complaining about an issue, and then they send the van around. If you just move around every other day, you will never be caught. But that's not even the issue. The issue is we have planes that work for the Forest Service flying around. If you have 5 gigahertz coming off, their FLIR systems and their radar systems are never going to be able to do communication at 5 gigahertz down to the ground to talk to the firefighters. This is a huge issue if we don't correct it.
I didn't get that completely. But I would like to keep that for later. Then we can discuss that. Back to Eric's points, he said all cases involved were profit companies like AT&T who misconfigured their routers and could easily be avoided by UI changes. And also that's another thing which is ripped from Eric's slide decks is for the weather radar, it only applies on quite a couple of
Yeah, sorry, the stream stopped on my side. I can't hear anything.
And that, yeah, you have to run that access point in 5 gigahertz range on a DFS channel and must have it to ignore the signal. Having the antenna outside be in the beam and only it happens if whoever radar is on, which is not always the case. But one thing which is also important, that if there's a disturbance for that weather radar, that's a very big problem for the airplane. So there are lives at risk at that point, right? So there's one more comment on that one, but we also keep that for now, because now we start the open discussion officially. We first have Max's statement from Max on the EU. After that, we will have an open discussion. We have an Everpad, which you can please use. You guys of you who have a laptop, please open that web page, document also what we said so far and what we talk about. So we have a track of what we did here. And then we have a couple of questions. But first we give it to Max. So Max, can you start? You have a big delay.
Okay, yes, I have a huge delay, but I will just simply start. Well, thanks to Simon for the informative introduction to the topic, and also thank you for the invitation to this conference, and thanks also to Will Lumpkins for the insights into the FCC and EU connections and all these technical details. I'm looking forward to the discussion already. Shortly about me, my name is Max Mehl. I'm working at the Free Software Foundation Europe, and there I'm the Germany coordinator doing policy work and public awareness. And yeah, since a few months, I'm working mainly on the radio directive in Europe. As some introductory words, I think we have to fight two battles at the same time. We have these FCC regulations and we have the EU radio lockdown. And I think we have to win both battles because we're speaking of the largest markets for these devices in the world. And if we lose one, then we lose both, I think. And because there was a question from the audience, even I don't know where all of this comes from. And it could be that it comes from the EU, I don't know. But it could be that this was a small fatal mistake by the EU Commission or the EU Parliament. It could also be a small lobby action by very, very few large single IT players. I don't know yet. But okay, I will start with a radio lockdown directive. So officially, this is called the Radio Equipment Directive 2014/53/EU, and which has been passed by the EU Parliament in 2015. At first sight, this is nothing spectacular. So it, in fact, just replaces the old RNTTE directive and does some harmonization, so a thing which is quite normal inside the EU. And the small goal is to improve the security of users and of frequencies. And but on the second side, it's very dangerous if we have a closer look at it, because it forces manufacturers to Sorry. Do you hear me? Do you still hear me?
Yeah.
Yes, okay, sorry. Then I will continue. I just saw you had a huge offset here in the stream. Okay, yeah, on the second side, the EU radio directive forces manufacturers to assess every possible software-hardware combination of every radio emitting receiving device, so emitting and receiving device, for conformity with applicable radio regulations. So the regulations which regulate the frequency and the signal strength and so on. So once again, manufacturers for this EU radio directive have to check every device, or let's say every software for every device which is able to run on these for conformity with the radio regulations. And we are not speaking only of Wi-Fi devices, we are speaking of all devices which can send or receive radio waves. So simply, for our understanding, this is a radio lockdown. And so some details about the directive itself. It has to be implemented in national laws, so in all 28 member states, until the 13th of June in 2016, so basically in just a few weeks. And the manufacturers, as Simon has told us, have to comply to this directive from June 2017. So from then on, those changes come into effect for the normal users and for the companies, of course, who have then to follow this directive. So that's our time frame. Why is this so important to us? Or what are the dangers for us? Well, as I said, it's not only Wi-Fi. So, but there are also more frequencies endangered by this. So basically, for example, Bluetooth, GPS, mobile phones, and basically all upcoming Internet of Things devices. So if we want to connect our fridges and washing machines in the future, it will also be affected by this radio lockdown directive. And the second thing I'm afraid of is the question how manufacturers enable or make this check of firmware possible. And I think they will have to install modules on their devices which work like the digital restriction management, so DRM, and which will be most likely proprietary, so non-free software. And these have to be installed on all radio devices because, as I said, the manufacturers have to check every software which can be loaded onto these devices. So they will have to lock down their devices, and somehow this has to be checked. And we've seen that with TP-Link, for example, that they do something like a DRM system. So basically, this has negative implications, for example, for all users. So we've seen that the default software which is onto these devices you can buy in the market. It's mostly the firmware is maintained for a few years and then there will be no security updates anymore. So basically the only way that users can secure their devices without buying a new one is to use something like OpenWRT on their devices. And with this directive, we are afraid that this will be much harder to do or almost impossible. And it's also impossible to use only free software because on these devices there will be something like these proprietary DRM modules installed. It also threatens free software projects like OpenWRT, CyanogenMod as well, because we are also speaking of mobile phones, OsmoCom, OpenWisp, and charity organizations and initiatives like Freifunk or Ninux. And it also endangers companies, for example, those which are creating Wi-Fi services based on free software routers. So, for example, on OpenWRT, and for example, on the local level, enabling people to use Wi-Fi for free, or even small device manufacturers, because they will also have to assess every firmware which can be loaded onto their devices, and which might be quite expensive to do, and might even ruin some business models, which is a bad thing, of course. And another threat is that there are currently no exceptions inside. So right now, we, as the only exceptions, we have devices which are used for military purposes, or I think rescue stuff and amateur radio. But like 99% of the populations are endangered by this radio lockdown directive. And the worst thing is that we can see almost no positive effect on security. And that's where Will Lumpkins will say something else. But as far as we understand it, this will not hinder criminals in doing their business. I'm pretty sure they will find ways how to circumvent this this protection of, or this lockdown. And the only ones who will be harmed by these restrictions will be normal users. It's the same, for example, like the DRM on music. We still see illegal music. It doesn't hinder criminals to share music on sharing platforms. Instead, normal users get backdoors installed on their devices, like we've seen with a Sony rootkit 10 years ago. So I would propose instead that we improve the criminal prosecution and the fines for illegal misuse of radio frequencies. We are totally totally agree with that, that we need fines for that. And for example, like Will said, that you cannot track mobile users. Yes, it can be hard, I can imagine. But first, I think there are only a few cases. And this compared to the whole population, which does nothing illegal and which you lock down, basically, I think that's not really fair. And still, then instead of locking down the whole users and the whole market, I'm totally in favor of increasing the budget of the FCC, for example, and also of the similar agencies throughout Europe. So far, what have we done? So in Europe, the EU lockdown directive or radio equipment directive was largely unknown until the fall of 2015. And when we heard of that, we there was almost no public information, at least concerning users' rights. So we created the first exhaustive information page and collected a lot of information which was necessary, and by doing so we built up a network of political actors, of other organizations fighting for users' rights, and also of companies which are affected by this directive. And together with this network, we created made a joint statement against radio lockdown with currently 35 signing partners, organizations and companies included, and which, by the way, is still open for subscriptions. So you can join with your organization or company to our joint statement. You will find it on our website. Unfortunately, I cannot show any slides here. And yeah, for example, we also sent a public letter to French ministries to find out what the situation on the national level. Well, what can we do? Like now it comes to how we can fight that. We see basically two chances or two channels. The first, very obvious one, would be that we go to the national legislations, to the 28 member states, and tell them to implement the necessary exceptions. So for example, that they have to make exceptions for normal users and companies, that they have to implement these exceptions themselves in their national laws. The problems that we see with that is that we have to open 28 different battle lines. So 28 national laws, and it's very hard. That's almost impossible, because on the one hand, we are partly too late. Some member states already implemented the law or the directive, sorry, into their national laws. And it's quite uncommon to change these afterwards. And some of them wait for a decision of the European Commission. So what can the European Commission do? In fact, the European Commission has been given the right to adopt so-called delegated acts. These delegated acts, in this case, can extend the list of devices which are not falling under the radio lockdown directive. So I've told previously that, for example, these military radio devices are excluded. So our plan or our idea is to basically exclude all, for example, all free software firmware from this list, so that every free software firmware is just excluded. But it would be even better, and that's our main goal, to exclude all consumer electronics. One idea would be, but we can discuss about that later, that we use the different device classes which are already existing. For example, there's the class 2, in which most of the consumer electronic devices are collected into. And yes, this would be one idea. So yeah, we are trying to tackle this problem on the European level with the European Commission instead of fighting on the national legislations. In general, we have to do three things. We have to gather more intel on how far the implementation on the national levels is, if the different member states are aware of this problem. And we have to find out what the European Commission is thinking. Do they plan any delegated acts? When will these delegated acts come, and what will they contain? So basically, there's almost no information on that. We have to create more publicity, so inform journalists and other projects, organizations, and companies about these threats. And we have to put more pressure, one on the member states, so to tell them they have to protect the user rights themselves, or to request the European Commission to make these plans public. So yeah, this was it already. I hope I was able to inform you about the EU Radio Lockdown Directive, and I hope I was able to tell you that this directive is in no way less dangerous than the FCC rules, if not even worse. Yeah, thank you for your attention, and I'm looking forward to the discussion.
Test. Okay, so that one works. Will, are you still with us? I would give you the word to give your position now, and then we can continue with the open discussion if you want.
Yes, I'm trying not to have a heart attack.
Will, do you want to speak? If you do, then please speak slowly, because you are a little hard to hear.
The interesting thing here is I know that everyone in the room means well, and I know the last speaker means well. The thing to remember is this started in 1999 from the European Union. I'm right now looking at documents in French and English from the European Union who started this.
Okay.
The biggest thing that kicked it off was June 2012, when the working group on SE from the R and TT&E did a complete study about the problem with at 5 gigahertz for with the weather radars and other things. One thing to remember is weather radars are not just at airports. Weather radars in all cities across the U.S., that's how they can track it for airplanes. When you happen to transmit at 5 gigahertz on that frequency, it causes a thing called a spin wheel effect in the airplane, where it actually has a spin wheel of a white line around the radar track, and the people actually can't really make things out on the radar. This isn't caused by 5 gigahertz, or mostly from industrial use. This is caused from 5 gigahertz with consumer electronic devices. This is the biggest problem. Now remember, another problem we seem to be misunderstanding here is that the chip guys have no problem locking just the radio. That's really easy. That's an easy fix. Every chip company can do it. That's not the problem. But they really can't lock the radio only because they're required by the European Union and they're required by the FCC to be able to put the radio in a specific state which actually violates this, so they can do testing for the EVM mask test. You can look that up, the EVM, right? It's a spectral mask test of the radar. And they have to put that in a special state. So what they normally do because of that is they create APIs and they lock certain parts of the radio. They have APIs. You can make API calls to the radio to make different things. And that's very doable. The problem that you guys are really talking about is not the chip manufacturer. The problem you're talking about is the OEMs, the companies that buy the chips implemented into their product. Those guys tend to be not well educated, even if they're electrical engineers or software engineers, on how to use the chip. They just get a data sheet, which has an API call. And you know, for a good example of this in the U.S., you'll find if you buy many access points for your home, you'll find it's all set to channel 11. Well, that's the default setting that most chip vendors provide. But you can change that to a channel 1, channel 5. But you'll find that a lot of companies lock out in their software, their upper-level software, so you can't change that the channel setting. There's no security requirement there. It's just they're lazy and they're doing it that way. So we have a difference. We have the OEM. Now, how the OEM wants to implement it, that's up to the OEM. And that's not really anything the chip vendor wants to do. The way to correct this, and I disagree with our previous speaker to say you should go after legislation in every country. That's not the way to do it. The easy way to do it is to go to the R and TT&E working group, especially the working group SE, go to them and say, hey, look, here's some new research. Where we can solve this problem, where we can coexist. And when you can show them research and energy in your different countries that we want to have a solution to this problem, then they can come up with a solution and they can change the RT&TE specification. And when they change it, the U.S. changes it because the U.S. follows whatever the European Union does. It doesn't go the other way around. Matter of fact, the FCC has 30 people in their technical arm in Washington, D.C. They have very few technical people in the FCC, where the RTT&E has a huge swath of scientists that work for them in that standards organization. So it's a very different group. I think the funny thing here is the European Union does most of the work, and the U.S. just copies it. Now, the European Union, because it's dealing with so many countries, is very slow to implement things, but the FCC monitors what's going on. And then when the FCC does something, then the Canadians follow suit with whatever the FCC did. And the Mexicans follow suit with whatever the FCC did. But all countries have to follow the European Union first, because that's the big deal. So remember, if you violate this spec in the European Union, you are barred from any U.S. company or any country that violates the European Union spec is barred 5 years of selling to any EU country. And the last fine I saw was it was a 1 million euro fine to sell in. And if you look at Minolta, a company I worked for many years ago, you'll find that Minolta Printer Laboratories, they got in trouble. They got caught because they didn't follow the CE mark testing requirement. They passed FCC, but they didn't pass European Union. Well, guess what? Minolta as a printer company doesn't exist anymore. They were barred 5 years from selling to the European Union and fined 1 million euros. It wiped that division. So the European Union is a very strong issue for Sasol. So the way to correct this, go to the RTT&E. Get them to change the requirements. They change the requirements, FCC will follow suit. It's very simple. Remember, these guys aren't technical, right? I don't work for the FCC. I just happen to be a guy that helps design hundreds and hundreds of radio parts, right? Same thing with laptops. Someone mentioned before, one way around this is to use a PCI general bus with a radio. Well, that's not really a way around anything, because if that module had implemented the controls of this thing, then you still have the same problem. So what you're talking about is you're trying to talk about bypassing what some OEM did on top of the software. Well, that's a totally different issue, right? I mean, I can grab any Dell PC with Windows off, throw Linux on there, and I can do whatever I want to the Wi-Fi radio. Matter of fact, I can go to the EEPROM itself and reflash the EEPROM or remove the EEPROM, put my own EEPROM on and do whatever the hell I want to do to the radio. That's a piece of cake. Now, the issue is if they lock it in that firmware where I could never submit new API calls, that could be a problem, right? But again, we can get around that. That's a piece of cake. Now, I agree with all of you guys. Hey, I was a hacker before I was out of high school. You know, hacking stuff left and right. And still, I consider myself a maker doing a lot of home projects. Do I support these rulings? No, abso-friggin' not. I don't support these rulings. I think they're terrible. And we need to work with the FCC and the European Union to try to correct them. But we need to remember, they're not doing this because companies lobbied. Are you kidding? No company on the planet, no one wants to change their firmware. No one wants to change their chip. Matter of fact, when I worked before at Y2Y, a very small company that is failing easily, when this new directive came in that we had to comply to the European Union requirements, companies everywhere were flipping out. Netgear was flipping out, and D-Link was flipping. Everyone was flipping out. How do we comply with this? How do we comply with this? You know, what do we do? And everyone was scrambling to try to comply. We were contacting Marvell and Qualcomm. Do you have any new ships that comply with the DFS requirements? And you know, what do we do? No one wanted to do it because it means you have to rebuild the design, which costs tons of money. No one wants to rebuild it. You know, there's no conspiracy there. They're happy to change the software and sell it as some new thing, but no one wants to change the hardware because, unfortunately, no one really cares about the hardware. This is coming from a hardware engineer, electrical engineer. So the thing to remember here is we need to work with them. The problem is if you take a combative attitude into solving a problem, people don't react well to competitive attitudes. If you can come up with a solution and work with people on a technical level, and remember, you're not just dealing with weather radar, you're dealing with airplanes, coastal surveillance. I work with Coast Guards, and I work with the firemen to deal with. So we have planes that run around, they use 5 gigahertz. We have to remember that 5 gigahertz is used for Bluetooth, it's used for a whole bunch of other things. It's even used the new ultra-wideband standards. You're going to be using 5 gigahertz on automobiles between automotive radar. That's a new big thing coming to Europe, and it's coming to the United States as we start to implement auto vehicles where vehicles can drive by themselves. That's going to be using 5 gigahertz as well as 24 gigahertz and 60 gigahertz. And those are automotive radars. So these are all affected. It's a huge issue. And if we don't take care of it, we're going to cause ourselves lots of problems. And no, we're not going to be able to track down who the abusers are, because the abusers is going to be someone like you and me who goes to the internet and buys a product from China. I get it through Amazon Prime. I get it. I pop it in my car, and I start causing someone problems in the next car. And the FCC is not going to have a million people running around trying to isolate and figure out who has this problem. It's just not going to happen. I mean, you can give them more budgets. I'm sure they'd love to have the money. But the better way to resolve this is to work with the RTT&E and those working groups and show them the data, come up with some solutions. That's what you can do. Talking to the chip manufacturers, that does nothing. They have to follow what the rules are. And if you were to tell the different countries, we want an exemption for every consumer electronics product, well, that's not going to happen because consumer electronics products are the ones that are causing the problems. So that's not the way to go. You're just going to be wasting your time writing letters. You know, make a solution. And by the way, again, I support you guys. So, you know, if you want to write some articles for the magazine, we would love to have it. And anyone in the room, like I heard Pedro talking earlier with some of his other topics, this is great stuff. We like the dialogue. We want the input in the magazine. We want people to chat about it. But you need to make sure you chat about it on a technical level if we're going to write about it. We have to use fact and not fiction. And that's what's most important. Thank you so much.
Okay. Thanks a lot for the comments. We will continue the discussion over here. I don't know if you already did, but we also have the pad. So maybe you can also use that to add a couple of more comments. I see some people have already noted your comments, but I think it's pretty much incomplete. Okay, so who's first in the audience?
Okay, hi, so I'm from Austria, and we have looked into this a bit. A few comments from me. Weather radar problems are not only caused by consumer devices. I know of a single problem in Austria, and that was caused by a commercial WISP who actually used a certified device with DFS enabled. So the problem is also DFS is not, depending on your noise situation, is not really working well. But that's a completely different problem. The slides, mitigate or workarounds more or less. Signed radio firmwares are in the EU document or in the EU standard not really possible because the device is always certified as whole. So, for example, if you took a radio chip or a radio module which is certified and put it inside a board in a mini PCI slot and put like a casing around it and sell it as a new device, it is a new device and it is a new conformity. You need a new conformity. So. The problem is, also in Europe, this document only describes the declaration of conformity. This is not a compliance test. It's only a legal document you have to more or less sign as a manufacturer and depending what you do, also on a vendor. So if this also applies to laptops, which it does, if it has a radio module inside, if you switch out your hard drive of your laptop as a vendor, you automatically become a manufacturer of the device by Article 14 of the EU document. So the problem is also if you are, the group who has the biggest problems with this.
Absolutely correct.
The group who has the biggest problems with that is actually not private persons or users, but small or bigger companies who are taking standard equipment like standard routers and selling or giving them to people for their ISP services. And they usually already by default become the vector and the manufacturer and have to take care of their devices. Even if they don't have the technical documents to do even so. And the problem is also, we were speaking with the Austrian Ministry of Transport, Information and Technology, who at the moment have the problem to implement this in Austria. And if you talk with them for a time they and speak about how technology usually works in wireless routers and so on, they become aware of the problems actually that comes with this article or with these articles. So they also say that they have, for example, the problem of car manufacturers who have Bluetooth-enabled devices in their cars, and because they are built inside the car, the whole car needs to be certified as whole. And if they update the firmware in the Bluetooth chip, the whole car needs to be certified again. And the problem is also the declaration of conformity combines hardware and software. So for every hardware revision and every software release, you have to have a declaration of conformity. So if you want to make a security release for your device, you have to sign a new declaration of conformity. So on a bigger, in a bigger company, you have to go through the legal team, which usually takes a few days at least.
Okay. Okay. Thanks a lot for the comment. I'm pretty sure it's not common practice to update the conformity.
I'd like to make one note, and I apologize to interrupt, but you're absolutely correct. And the funny thing about the European Union when it comes to the declaration of conformity is you test it, you get compliance, you sell your product. The people that go after you is not the European Union. The competitor buys your product, they take it to a lab and they test it, and if they see that it fails, they take the failed data, they send it anonymously to the European Union and say, we believe they failed their compliance. The compliance union, all they do is paperwork, they send a request to that product creator and say, please send us the proof that shows that this version passed. And if you can't show the pictures of that exact unit and the test results showing it to pass, then you're in violation. So the European Union doesn't have a police force running around trying to find the problem. They monitor themselves by other vendors doing it, and they do a great job. By the way, the FCC doesn't do that. People don't write in complaints about other people. The only time the FCC gets involved is if they start having people dying in the hospitals, or people can't use their cell phones, or the GPS doesn't work in a particular area. And after about a few thousand people making complaints, then the FCC sends out a truck to try to figure it out.
Okay. Next one, Gui.
So going back to the idea, like the other way of fighting this, we already started a month ago a project or discussing the idea of doing our own router as a group of community networks that are outside of Europe and the US, and that we are also affected by the same regulations. But not because the regulations apply in our countries, but because the vendors don't have the resources or don't want to put the resources into having two versions. So non-EU or US version. So the idea is to take the problem on our own hands and build an open hardware that we can use in the rest of the world. And with the hope as well that this is also a step that can be used to fight the regulations in Europe and the US. Like, it might not be entirely clear in the beginning, but this can be used, like this example can be used to say that the regulations are nonsense, or that they are not needed, because if the rest of the world is still being able to use equipment that is still open to modifications and doesn't have any problem with weather radars or whatever, then it's a case it helps the cause, I think. So we are already talking with Steve, like from different past projects, like Steve Song from Village Telco, and also from the people from Rizomatica, which also made a similar case that doing GSM networks in Mexico or anywhere in the world was illegal, and they made it anyway, like a civil disobedience technique. And after some months, they presented the case to the national regulator, and got a special license. And afterwards, like, they continued that down that path and got a law that said that the regulator would allocate like 5 MHz or 10 MHz to community initiatives. So GCM community-owned networks are legal in Mexico thanks to the work of Rizomatica. And even though the law doesn't mention Rizomatica as an organization, it says experiences in Oaxaca, which means Rizomatica. So I think we should learn from these experiences. And so the idea at this battle mesh was to put this subject as well. And anyone that is interested, I will be very willing to talk. I've been talking with the Batman people who have a lot of experience from open mesh, and also with Felix and on the perspectives of all of this. And even though it will be difficult, it's definitely not impossible. So yeah.
Okay, thanks a lot for those from outside. That was Guido from Argentina. So just to get the idea, it's not from Europe and not from US.
And the networks that we are talking about are, like, Steve has been working all this time in South Africa, and we've been working in networks in Brazil, in Nicaragua, and there are people here from Bogota, from Colombia, that also are part of the initial group, like of the interested parties. So that's more or less, and probably some people from India will be interested. So.
So, comments? Any more comments? Yes.
Hi, this is Leonardo from Italy. Okay, the first thing I would like to ask to both of you, if you are aware of where this is all coming from, like, do we have any data or any study from the European Union or from the FCC that tell us that there is like a specific problem on this? Because as long as we don't have anything like that, then it is hard to understand why both entities are doing something that, as William said, it's a pain for a lot of people and for a lot of business too. And the second question is more maybe for the audience. We'll say that it should be fairly easy to lock down the functions that are that we are talking about in the chip or somewhere in the firmware and enable them with an API, so that this should give the freedom to the OEM to let people reflash the device as long as the radio device itself it's locked somehow. And I would like to know if everybody here, I mean, if all you here agree. I don't know, I'm not a low-level developer, and I don't know if this will cause other problems, like with proprietary blobs that we had in the past for other firmwares.
I would like to answer on the second question, because I've been involved in development of ATH9K, which is open source driver for the Qualcomm chips. And I know about all the low-level stuff, not at all about all, but I know how it works in general. And there is no such thing as API. So what we really have access to are registers, and we can write to these registers, and there is no firmware in between. So actually, you can write the frequency, for example,
that's
as a register.
That's not true for the Qualcomm chips. I use them every day.
Okay. William uses a Qualcomm chip too. That is what I heard. What I wanted to say is you can actually tune the frequency pretty easily by just writing to a couple of registers. So there's no layer in between. You can even set it to illegal values like 4.9 gigahertz, which definitely is not covered. And yeah, that's also pretty much in all the routers we use here. And all of these routers, I think it's impossible to lock down only the radio part. So yeah, It might be possible for other newer devices, I think, which have a separate firmware on the chip, but I don't think
it's... So yes, you can if you write straight to the registers. The issue here is Qualcomm generally does not release the register settings to non-Qualcomm developers. What they release is an API, and you can make API calls. Now, they could lock the registers for the radio itself, so you can't do that. As I said before, the problem is you have to do an EVM mass test, which requires you to take it out of the bounds of legality for the test, because it depends on the different regions of the countries you're doing the test for.
Well, the country is ruled by a value in the EEPROM, which you will read out, and then the driver has to interpret that. And the driver is completely open source, and it's very easy today to change any of these things. So everyone who uses Linux, there's no API. Of course, normal users use a driver and don't have direct access. But with a little bit of documentation, which is openly available, not under NDA.
Again, I agree with you. What I'm saying is you can lock that down. You can lock that down. But I agree with you. You can do that.
So how would you think you can lock that down technically?
So technically, the chip manufacturer can lock those registers. So that, I mean, they just make it a ROM. They make it read-only. Right now, they're read-write-only for those registers.
Okay, but for example, for Qualcomm chips, the DFS functionality is completely in software, so it's a
all
hardware.
All you do is make a separate mask for the chip, and chip manufacturers do that all the time when they want to do a low current version. They mask out. They make a mask that regulates certain areas. It's very common.
Okay. I think we have a pretty long delay here. I agree that it is possible for the hardware manufacturer to mark registers read-only. But in fact, the chips, all of these chips which they sell today and which are on the market, are not locked in this way. So they definitely first have to be changed and sold again, and the others have to be taken out of market. And I think this is not going to happen. So I don't think we will see solutions based on these old chips.
Oh, I didn't say that you could. You were asking how it could be done, and I'm saying, yes, that's how it could be done.
Right, okay. Yeah?
Just a quick input to the idea to make us a new router with a certified radio driver.
And actually, to the person's first question, there is test data. It exists. I mean, I'm looking at the email here for the European Union. It says it was finalized in November 2012. I don't have the data myself. It says it came out of the working group SE, Annex 23, which highlights the problem. This seemed to come from a Monsieur Lucio Conchantelli, I guess, out of France, Rue de l'Air. His email, just do a search from the RTTNE. 8th July 2013, the source chairman of the ADCO RTTNE, and there it mentions the data they used, and then you'd have to go contact the RTTNE and then get their data set for what they did for that.
Thanks for digging that out. It would be great if you can add this information to the pad I think you should have a link by now by email. So if you could fill in this information, that would be great. I will give another to another comment in the audience.
Just if we have this idea and we make a...
I can send it to Simon. I don't know what the pad thing is. I'm on the YouTube BattleMesh live stream, and I made a couple comments, but I don't know what the pad is. If that's the Jitsi thing, I don't have access to that.
Leonardo will send you an email, or he already did, so there should be a link in that, and if you click on that link, as you maybe also can see, we have it on the projector, it's very colorful. It's like a notepad, where a collaborative notepad where everyone can fill in some text, and we are recording the comments manually, everyone in the audience, so you can also add your comments through that. So just follow the link from the email, please. I will give it to the audience now. Yeah, we try not to interrupt now with our delay. Thanks.
Okay, if we do our own router with a wireless chipset and we make a driver that is certified for this hardware and works. The problem is this only works as long as we can more or less lock down the radio completely and nobody knows how to actually interact with the hardware. So only there is the software which is interfacing with it, and as soon as somebody finds out how to abuse more or less this wireless chip, the whole hardware loses its certification. That's the main problem with the current radio chips.
Any more comments here? Audience comments? More audience comments? Getting quiet here now. Okay, one more.
So it seems TP-Link is locking everything down already, right? More or less. Is TP-Link stuff even interesting for some people if it's only stock firmware? I mean, is it for others?
Yeah.
Is the software quality decent enough in order to use it? So, okay. So they can afford to ignore not serving us.
So, the question is if anyone uses that stuff or if it's enough. Of course, there are these security problems, performance problems, but I think for the average home user, stock firmware is just fine. And we also have to see that our community who reflashes the router is still in the, I'm not sure if it's even the 1% digit of the TP-Link users. We have to face that. So, okay. One more comment in the audience.
Is there a central hacking site? Did anybody just sample all these things to get around the lockdown? I tried to follow up who made this and this and what model, and they could circumvent it and they could hack it and that goes. But there is no somebody who gets all these things to say model E you can put this and model B you can do this. Just to go over time, you know. Now, is there any information gathered somewhere? How to hack it? So how to get off the lockdown? Yeah.
So from my information, the lockdown for TP-Link has already been circumvented. At least I've seen some emails on that. So that's
there's a whole bunch on Darknet on the onions. You just have to be careful in your country, or if your ISP might disable you from going there. But there's about 20 different ones on how to do it.
I didn't really understand that, unfortunately, from the audio quality, but I will just continue. What I was saying is the problem which I fear would might happen is as soon as there's a way to hack it. It's a hole in the well, in the security process, and there might be competitors which come around and say, hey, this is not really working according to the rules, so there has to be a sales stop. And then there will be a cat and mouse thing going on between competitors, hackers, and users. This is the fear I have with that. So I don't know if I wouldn't even advise as a hacker to make a public page on that. Well, how I know it was the question, and I read it on some mailing list.
Yeah, I'm just saying something to that. Sorry, I also encourage users to tackle this on a European level, and not with a technical level, because this is a fight we cannot win, and this is really a cat and mouse game. And yes, please join us in doing this on a political level, and not trying just to hack around. I think this will not solve anything in the full scope.
Okay.
Yeah, this is why, like, we are proposing to make our own router, because we believe that the political fight is a key one, and so far there's not a lot of success, so we must try other ways at the same time. And to give a short example, after these first networks in Mexico, there are other countries who are also doing this, and they are like, it's not automatic that you get to do it legally in other countries, but you can point to that example. You said, look, in Mexico, they have this very restrictive law, and they lift it off because of there were community networks. Like,
okay, I think we should close the session soon. It's getting late, people are tired, I need a coffee. So I would have one or two closing comments from the audience, if there's any, and then I would like to give it also to Max and Will for closing comments. So anyone in the audience who wants to make another comment? Daniel, yes?
I haven't followed all the discussion, but I just asked, and I heard that the mobile phones industry's interests in that context have not yet been mentioned. And I think it's quite important to put into context that the 5 gigahertz band we currently use for Wi-Fi, which is now the UNII band, it can and will also be used by mobile phone providers to provide LTE minus U. In the license, U is for unlicensed band. That means that what they previously had to buy for a lot of money, you remember those auctions, usually, like, you know, you could finance a state for some years by those mobile phone frequency band sellouts. So by the mobile phone industry pushing into the free bands, they obviously have an interest to get as large as possible part of the shared resource, which is the radio spectrum. I think it's important to consider that as a possible lobby interest, which might have triggered this whole debate, especially if you see it with current developments in the market, that basically all mobile phone carriers have paired up with ISPs, which run large amount of centrally managed access point fleets, which now become a marketable resource, not only to the primary customer who has this access point in the house, but also to walk by people, so you can kind of sell the thing twice and get the electricity for free and don't pay for the band. So for the mobile phone industry, this is a dreamingly nice condition. And I just didn't want to leave that unmentioned.
Okay. One more. You are the last one.
Yeah, I'm still Leonardo from Italy. And I would just wanted to mention that in Italy, we have a draft of the law that will enforce it. And it is still a draft, so it may change. But at first analysis with other people and lawyers too, it does not apply only on 5 gigahertz. It applies to anything that is below 3 terahertz. So we can use something that is higher than 3 terahertz, but and it actually says that it applies to anything that can transmit or receive radio waves for communications, which means that your GPS device should actually be compliant with that. It may be changed in the future, but this is the way that they are implementing it in Italy now.
Okay, thanks a lot. So we will have closing comments if you want. First from Will, then from Max, I would say. So Will, please continue after the delay.
Sure, I just want to say thank you very much for giving me the opportunity to listen in and forward some comments. I apologize if I seem a little too energetic. I know that all of you really mean well, and I know a lot of you are coming from the software, firmware realm, not so much from the hardware aspect, and probably not for FCC compliance aspect or CE compliance aspect. I think this is an important issue, and the thing to point out is the EU guys aren't all that technical, and the FCC guys aren't all that technical. So since you guys are in the field and you have a lot of exposure, it's good if you can create data sets. Like I saw some of like Pedro and some of the other folks provide some slides and presentation material. And when you send your comments in to the RTT working groups and to like FCC, you include those data sets. That's really important. Just sending a kind of a nasty email does nothing. They get a nasty email, they delete it. A nasty letter, they delete it. But if you actually send some substance, and the contact information, then they're happy to work with you and come up with an idea. The other problem is, remember, companies really don't want a big issue on the physical layer. They really want to have a product that customers want to buy. It does you no good to develop an amazing, very overly complicated product that no one will purchase. And the other problem is product teams disappear after 3 years. So, you get hired to do a project, you're working on it for 2 or 3 years, and then you're moved off of that project to something else. So sustainability is pretty much a non-concurrent activity. That's why it's great to have the maker-hacker community that can take this old stuff. What I wish we could do, when products get old, I wish we could take those firmwares and just open it up and allow it to go out there, almost like a GNU common license. And interestingly enough, early on in Silicon Valley and Intel, companies like that, they used to do that. They would release the source code and say, hey, here's it, go ahead and use it. The problem would be is that hackers, small businesses would take that code, implement it, and then something would happen, right? There'd be a car crash, and then the lawyers would sue. But the people that made that little modification wouldn't had no money, so they would go after the people that they made the original firmware code, which had to be Intel or Microsoft or whoever, and they had money, and they got sued for hundreds of millions of dollars. And after that, their legal staff said, "Do not ever release firmware source code. Don't release source code again, unless you can guarantee it'll never be affected. Or if you do release it, it has to be released with a statement, which we will not be held liable. Even then, they don't like to release it." So that becomes problematic. But you should absolutely keep up your internal development, so you should always question and ask, and I think it's important. And please, if you feel the bug to write an article, we would love to publish you in the Consumer Electronics Magazine. I'm always open to criticism, preferably technical criticism, to make sure I get something right on the technical level. But I'd be eager to work with anyone in the room at any time. Please understand, though, I have a day job. My day job is designing airplanes for the U.S. government and right now for the Japanese government, mostly Coast Guard planes. So I have a day job. So I just have to be careful how much time I spend on non-monetary generating things and not have my wife get mad at me. So again, I want to say thank you so much, and I'm open for any comments later. Thank you.
Okay. Thanks a lot. To now, Max, please, and then I will close the session.
Yeah, thank you. I will make it short. You all want to go home. Thanks for all the comments and the ideas we shared together here. And thanks especially to William. Yes, please, let's stay in contact. I liked your ideas and your thoughts. We should exchange our knowledge. And I also invite other organizations and companies to sign our joint statement. The link should be in the pad. And yeah, please try to keep on track what we as the FSFE and the other organizations are doing on the political level. And once again, my last statement, technical restrictions are the wrong way for Europe and for the USA to solve criminal activities. I'm pretty sure about that. But to solve this problem, like the problems that we see now with the EU radio lockdown directive and the FCC regulations, we should use political solutions for that. As Will said, let's try to contact them, get in touch with them, and try not to find only technical solutions, because this will be short-lived solutions and a cat and mouse game. And yeah, that's simply also that what our experience as an organization teaches us every day, that political solutions are the right way. Yeah, so we have to talk to the European Commission here in Europe, and we have to ask them to use their right to make delegated acts, so to expand the list of exceptions from this radio directive. And together we have to gather more information about what's happening in the member states. And for this, of course, we could use your help. So yeah, please feel welcome. Thank you very much for the invitation.
Okay, thanks a lot, Max. So I'm going to close the session. I have some more further readings in the slide. It's not for you to type now. I will upload the slides to the BattleMesh wiki after the talk, so you can download the slides, check it again, click on the links. There's also the magazine thing from William. I didn't use the IEEE because that's behind the paywall, so that's a SkyHub, which is free, and also FSFE is on that, and a couple of other news things. You can, if you're interested, you should also join the mailing lists from Purple Foundation and Bufferbloat, so we can continue the discussion in a larger group there, if you're interested. Right, so thank you very much for your attention. Also, thank you very much for William to join us in that call and give us his opinion, which is from a very different angle, but it was extremely helpful. And also thank you very much, Max, to join us and give us all that information. That was great. And yeah, finally, thanks to the local team here who helped us setting up the audio. I'm sorry that it took a little longer, but I'm very happy that we made it and we could actually bring also the remote participants in. That was really great. Yeah, thanks a lot, and enjoy the rest of the evening.